So good evening all of you and welcome to this first session of our new course that we are starting from today. So I hope my voice is audible. Yes, okay. So thanks a lot everyone for joining this course. I and Akanksha are thankful to all of you. And this is a new course, RCC building design for earthquake loads. So mainly we would be focusing in great detail about the design of RCC buildings for EQ loads through the two Indian standards, that is 1893 and 13920, both of which have been revised in the year 2016. So we would be focusing more on the beam column frame type of a system, because that is the most usual system that you come across. And then we would be talking a few things about the shear walls as well. So that is how we are going to cover things in this course. Today we will have just a quick sort of a basic session, just to talk about the basic details about earthquake design, earthquake engineering, and mainly about the earthquakes we will try to talk about. All right. So during the course, most of you have taken courses with us in the past, but I'll just quickly repeat that during the session, you would be kept on mute and you will not be able to turn on your video also. So the way to communicate is through chat box. You can put your questions in the chat box and we are constantly going to monitor it. Whatever doubts, difficulties, questions, queries, whatever you have, whenever you have, you can just put them in the chat box. Okay. So that is one advantage of conducting online courses, that if you have any hitch or if you don't feel, some people have this tendency that they don't feel like asking because of some hitch, isn't it? So there's no need to be bothered about anything. You can just chat, write it in the chat box and we would answer your queries. All right. No need to wait till end also. If you have a doubt, you can type your doubt then and there. If it is relevant, we will take it as soon as you post, we will take your question if it is relevant. If not, at suitable time, your doubt would be answered. Other than that, after the completion of every session, last 5-6 minutes, we keep it for queries. So if there are some remaining queries, you can ask during that time also. What else I wanted to tell you? Yeah. So these were some basic things I wanted to tell you. This would be a detailed design course. We would be doing a lot of numericals, a lot of things we would be doing by manual method, manual calculations we would be doing. So always keep a calculator handy with you. All right. It would be beneficial if you have a calculator, pen, paper ready. There would be no notes as such. So we will not be sharing any printed notes or any PDF documents, notes that is. So it is suggested that you take notes on your own. All right, so good. So why does the earth shake? This is the most fundamental question when it comes to earthquake engineering. So we all know, we have learned this in geology, that earth shakes because the earth's crust is not made up of a continuous surface, but those surfaces are broken at places. And these surfaces lie on a semi-solid molten type of a material that is called as magma. And there is continuous movement in the magma because of temperature changes and those geological, processes, because of which the earth's crusts are constantly interacting with each other or moving with respect to each other, isn't it? So the map that you see right now, it is not stationary. The countries are constantly moving. And what you see right now, the position of different land masses, different continents, those were different in the past and those will change in the future, isn't it? You must have seen the different types of land masses clubbed together in the past and how they now look like and what will the future be. So you must have seen those different types of maps showing the motion of the land masses over the millennium or millions of years. All right. So right now, this is the position of these land masses. And the lines that you see are the major, you could say the major lines where your crusts meet. All right. So quickly, we will just go through it. Even though we live in India, why to bother about other locations? But as a structural engineer, we should be interested in the entire earth, that is, because our work is very closely related with the geography and geology, isn't it? So is my voice audible before I go ahead? Is my voice audible to all? Hello. Yes, okay. So very quickly, let us quickly see the major plates. So this is the Indian plate, you can see. And this is the fault line. Generally, where your plates are joined with each other, they are called as the fault line. So you can see this plate. This is the Indian plate. You can see that the Indian plate is a independent plate in itself. So therefore, sometimes our country and the neighboring countries are also called as the Indian subcontinent, isn't it? So it is a completely individual plate in itself, this Indian subcontinent plate. So therefore, you see a lot of varying geology, a lot of different geographical features you find it in India that you generally don't get elsewhere. So Indian subcontinent is a independent separate plate in itself. All right. And that has come to join the Eurasian plate. And because of this, all of us know that what is the geographical feature that has been formed because of this action, because the Indian plate slowly over the years merged with this Eurasian plate, which is the geographical feature that was created due to it. So due to this, we all know that the Himalayan mountains were created, isn't it? So the entire Himalayan mountain range that you see, which actually stops over here, but if you try to understand, it extends right till this location, isn't it? So these are my Himalayan mountains. These are the Himalayan mountains. These are the Karakoram ranges. And you will have Hindu Kush ranges, Karakoram ranges, parallel ranges you have over here. So all these mountain ranges basically have been formed because of the motion of Indian plate and because of the joining of Indian plate with the Eurasian plate, isn't it? Those mountain chains continue. If you have seen the geographical features of the neighboring portions of India, those geographical features continue till here. And what is one geographical feature that you find over here? Can anyone tell me what is one geographical feature that you find over here? Yes. Anyone? This portion where I have highlighted with a green circle, what is the geographical feature that you find over here? So here you find your Andaman and Nicobar Islands, isn't it? You find your Andaman and Nicobar Islands. So those Andaman and Nicobar Islands are nothing, but they are also actually the, you could call them as sea mountains, isn't it? Those are outcrops coming out of the sea floor and they are reaching till here, till the sea level. So they are nothing but the underground mountains that have been formed. So you would appreciate that this entire line where your Indian subcontinent, Indian plate met with Eurasian plate. You have distinct land features. You have this Himalayan mountains, the extension of Himalayan mountains, and then you have got the Andaman Nicobar Islands. In the same curvature, if you recall, it is the same curvature that you get, isn't it? So this Indian plate is a independent plate in itself. Now, because this is an independent plate in itself, and this is not static. That means the Indian plate is still moving towards the Eurasian plate. So you might have heard that the Himalayan mountains are still growing. Growing means they are still getting taller and taller. So I think in the last 100 or 200 years, even the height of Mount Everest has increased by around 3 or 4 centimeters, I think. Okay. So pretty fast growing mountains these are. Why they are still growing, or why they are still getting taller and taller? Because the Indian plate is still, or it continues to move towards the Eurasian plate. All right. Because of which these Himalayan mountains continue to rise up. What is the name of these Himalayan, what is the name of this type of mountain formation? Yes, anyone, we all have studied this in our geology or geography courses. So what is the name of this type of a geographical feature? Like the Himalayas that you get. So these are called as fold mountains, isn't it? What are these called as? These are called as the fold mountains. Fold mountains means, because two landmasses came together. So I had one landmass over here and I had second land. I'm trying to draw a section of it. I had a second landmass over here. And because these landmasses are coming close to each other, what happens? That the material or whatever is over here in between, that rises up. So because of this rising up, you get your Himalayan mountains. So these are also called as the fold mountains, all right? If you compare it with the other mountain ranges in India, for example, if you compare it with the Western Ghats that you have over here, or you compare it with the Eastern Ghats, or even if you compare it with the Aravallis, all those are not fold mountains, okay? Those are the ranges, mountain ranges formed because of volcanic depositions. So those are not fold mountains. So, fold mountains are Himalayas in our country. Himalayas and the neighboring ranges of Karakoram and the Hindu Kush mountains, etc. Anyway, other than this, if you see, where are the major joints of tectonic plates? These are also called as tectonic plates. So, this will be called as one tectonic plate. This will be called as the other plate and so on. So, other than this, where do you see the joinings of two plates? So one major location where you will see this is in this region, isn't it? This entire Indonesian islands, the islands of Sumatra and Java, all these are on your junction of a tectonic plate, isn't it? This entire region of Japan, if you see right from here, there are multiple plates that are joining in the or near the Japanese islands, multiple plates getting joined over here. All right. If you see in the Americas, then this entire region is on the junction of a tectonic plate. This entire is a junction of tectonic plates, isn't it? So wherever you have plates, wherever you have junctions of plates, there the vulnerability to earthquake effects is pretty high. You would be getting seismically active locations at the junctions of these plates. All right. So you must have heard, if I asked you, which are the major earthquakes that you have heard in the past? In the past, which have been the major earthquakes that have struck across the world? Yes. Could someone just name a few major earthquakes that you have heard in news or that you have read elsewhere, read somewhere? What are those locations, if someone can tell? Hello. Yes, you can write it in the chat box. So Prasad sir is saying Bhuj earthquake, that is in the Gujarat region over here, somewhere over here. Okay. Then Latur was not a very big earthquake as such, but yes, it was decently medium range earthquake. Mexico was a big earthquake that shook. So Mexico would lie somewhere over here. Koyna earthquakes, Kilari earthquakes, yes, they were not very big as in the biggest that have ever struck the world. They were not that big, but yes, they were big. You must have heard big earthquakes striking the Kashmir region in the past also. This entire region you see, the entire Nepal region, that is on the junction of a tectonic plate. You might have heard big earthquakes striking Turkey. You might have heard about big earthquakes striking Turkey. So Turkey is somewhere over here. This is Turkey actually. Okay, this is Turkey. Turkey in itself is an independent plate if you see, isn't it? Turkey in itself is an independent plate. So Turkey is extremely seismically prone region. This entire Iranian region, this is Iran, modern day Iran, Persia. So this entire Iranian region is prone to high earthquakes. This entire region of Indonesian islands, what Mr. Swapnil is saying, this entire region of Indonesian islands are extremely prone to earthquakes and tsunamis, of course. The Japanese islands, the Japanese islands are again, I have marked these lines, blue lines. These Japanese islands are again very susceptible to high earthquakes. Then if you come to South America, this Chile, the country of Chile over here, your South American countries, Brazil, Colombia, all countries over here are extremely prone. You might have heard about the earthquakes striking Californian regions. So those are over here. You might have seen a Hollywood movie, San Andreas. Have you heard about this movie, San Andreas? There was a famous Hollywood movie, San Andreas, isn't it? Yes, you might have heard it. So this is the San Andreas fault, actually. This is the San Andreas fault. So it is a very prominent fault line and highly susceptible to very, very large earthquakes. Okay. So this is a big region in the world which is highly prone to the earthquakes. And therefore, not very surprising that in the Californian state itself, you have this University of California at Berkeley, isn't it? You might have heard this. UCB, what do we call it as? University of California at Berkeley. So this university is actually very near to this San Andreas fault, very, very near to a very active, very active, seismically vulnerable area. So not surprisingly, this is the university that has done a lot of work in dynamics, actually. This university, University of California at Berkeley, this is one university that has done a lot of work in dynamics of structures. Okay. And these are the people actually where the professors and students have teamed together and they have come up with this CSI company, Computers and Structures Incorporate, which develops or which produces ETABS and SAFE, SAP 2000. All these softwares are actually developed by this CSI, which is a company founded by students and professors of this very university. You might have heard about A.K. Chopra, Professor A.K. Chopra and his books on dynamics. Someone of you might have read it also. So Professor A.K. Chopra is from this college, UCB. Okay. So not surprising, because they are very near to a very active fault. In the entire United States of America, if you see, a university which is doing great work in field of earthquake engineering is this UCB. All right. Anyway. This was just some information I was sharing. Now, other than these areas, yeah, another interesting point, just like Himalayas in Asia were at a junction of two tectonic plates. Similarly, you see, someone with good sense of geography can tell me what are these mountain ranges in South America called as, where I am highlighting with a red color right now. What are these mountain ranges called as? Yes. Anyone? So these are called as, Peru is the country. These are called as Andes. Okay, these mountain ranges are called as the Andes. All right. So if you see, these Andes mountain ranges are also at the junction of two tectonic plates, just like Himalayas were at the junction of two tectonic plates. Similarly, Andes is also at the junction of two plates. What is the mountain range? What is this mountain range called as? Yes, anyone? This mountain range where I am putting my brown pen. So this mountain range is called as, yes, I am waiting for an answer actually. So this is called as Rockies, isn't it? This is called as the Rockies. So Rockies, Andes, the Himalayan mountain ranges, all these ranges are actually at the junctions of major tectonic plates in the world. And these are seismically very vulnerable areas. So major areas I have marked, which are seismically very vulnerable, all these lines that I have marked, these are the vulnerable areas that you have. Other than these regions, Africa is predominantly, predominantly not prone to earthquakes. You see, the entire European continent is not prone to earthquakes. Only Turkey, because part of Turkey is in Europe, so Turkey is prone to earthquakes. In Asia, if you see, the Iranian region, the Turkish region, Central Asian region, and the Himalayan region, and then you have got the Indonesian islands and Japanese islands. All these are seismically active. Other than this, everywhere else, actually, it's a pretty, I would say, not a very seismic prone areas. All right. So this image I have taken from your general Google images that you get on the internet. It was an interesting image, therefore I thought to share it with you. All right. This is also, yes, one more interesting. What you see, this line over here, this is also called as the African rift line. Okay, rift means where two plates join. So this is called as the African rift line. So many great rivers of Africa, they actually originate in this region and they follow this rift line and then they go to, let us say, if you take the case of Nile River, it originates somewhere over here in the Rift Valley. It is called as the Nile Rift Valley and then it goes to the Mediterranean Sea. Anyway, so this was a broad tectonic plate map of the world. Next is a map that I have taken from internet again. It has been developed by the University of Tokyo. It has been developed by the University of Tokyo. And this actually has marked all these dots that you see are actually the epicenters of earthquakes that they have recorded in the past. One thing I'm not very sure that of how many years data has been plotted over here. I'm not very sure, but I would say around 50-60 years data they must have marked over here. So all these small points that you see are the epicenters of the earthquakes they have measured. So I am showing you this map just to highlight that point, that all these locations, you would agree that all these locations are on the junctions of the tectonic plates, isn't it? I just showed you the tectonic plate map. this was the tectonic plate map that I had showed you, this one. So all the epicenters that you see being marked, they are more or less on these junction lines. What is junction line? Junction line means where these two plates are meeting each other. All right. So that will help you to understand in a better way. All right. All these, you can see very well the locations of past earthquakes. This entire region, this which starts from the Japanese islands and it goes right up to this region. Do we know, does anyone know what is this also called as? This imaginary line that you can see, does anyone know what is this called as? So generally, or it is also known as the ring of fire. Yes, what Mr. Akash has written, it is also called as the ring of fire. Why? Because this region is very vulnerable to very, very high intensity earthquakes and volcanoes both. Okay, so this entire region, which is called as the ring of fire, this is extremely prone to the heavy intensity earthquakes. If you have heard about the deepest point on Earth, I don't know if you have heard about it. The deepest point on Earth is called as the Mariana Trench, isn't it? If I remember the name correctly. And it is, I think, minus 11,000 meters below sea level, that is. So that point is also somewhere in this region, if I remember correctly, somewhere over here in the Pacific, you get that point, Mariana Trench. Anyway, so these are the past earthquake epicenters marked. Again, you can see those are on junctions of tectonic plates. This entire belt over here, Rockies, the Andes, this is San Andreas Fault, the Japanese islands, the entire Indonesian islands, okay, the Himalayan region, the Karakoram, Hindu Kush Mountains, Iranian Plateau, Turkey, all these are the locations of past earthquake. Very interesting. So as I told you at the beginning, as a structural engineer, we should have some basic sense of geography, isn't it? Because finally, at the end of the day, we have to construct anything that we construct is on a piece of land. And when it comes to study of land, basically, we should be good with geography, geology. These subjects are important for structural engineers. Anyway, so this was a broad idea. Now, this was the idea of the entire world. If we come to India, if we come to our country India that we would be talking about, how do we decide the intensities for our country? Yes, how do we decide the seismic intensities for our country? So we have been given what is called as a seismic zone map, isn't it? What I am sharing with you right now. So this is called as a seismic zone map, and the entire Indian country has been divided into four zones. Starting from seismic zone 2, it goes onwards to seismic zone 5. I think till about 1984, which was the last time this code was published. Last time was 2002. Before it, I think it was in the year 1984. I'll just confirm this year. We had zone one also. No, I don't think, I'll just cross-check when the zones were merged together, whether in 2002 or 84, I'll just cross-check it. So later on, what they did, zone one and zone two were merged. And now you have got starting from zone two. Okay. So zone two is the region having the lowest seismic vulnerability, and 5 is the most vulnerable region. Now, if you see the entire map, as you can now correlate with the tectonic plate map that I had showed you, the entire Himalayan region, right from here, and the Nepal border, your entire northeast, this all lies in seismic zone 5. Okay, because you had a active fault line through this region, plus the entire region of Gujarat, Kutch region of Gujarat, if I could say, this also lies in zone 5. Because if you remember, there is a tectonic plate very close to Gujarat region, isn't it? Then the entire islands of Andaman and Nicobar, because it was nothing but an extension of this tectonic line, tectonic plate, this region is also in zone 5. Then you will see large parts of northern India are in zone 4, which is the next highest region. The entire Kashmir, Union Territory of Kashmir, Ladakh, the states of Uttarakhand, Himachal Pradesh, Punjab, and the northern parts of Uttar Pradesh, they are kept in zone 4. One more reason for keeping them in zone 4 is called as the near zone effect. So this is a technical term, near zone effect. What is the meaning of near zone effect? Near zone effect means if your location lies close to a highly seismically vulnerable zone, then your location also gets, the risk at your location also increases. What does it mean is Nepal is seismically very active. So all the regions near Nepal, they have been given a higher seismic zone, all right, because of the near zone effect or near zone factor. Delhi, they have deliberately and they have sort of, if you can see, they could have easily continued this yellow line like this. They could have continued the yellow line like this from here to here, but deliberately they have included Delhi in zone 4, isn't it? Why? Why they have deliberately included Delhi in zone 4? Why they have taken this line and sort of brought it inside just to cover Delhi and then taken it elsewhere? Because, yes, as Shivani is saying, because it is a national capital region, so to emphasize the importance of our capital and to, of course, construct structures. I mean, because the structures would be constructed, would be at a very strategically and sensitive location for our country, so therefore they have kept this in higher zone, okay, Delhi. Other than this, if you other than this region of locations near Nepal and the Kashmir region and Ladakh region and the northeast and of course our Kutch and Andaman Nicobar, other regions you find mainly in zone 3, isn't it? So this region you see in zone 3, this is zone 3 yellow. This is the plain of the Ganga River. You can say this is the plain or plains of Ganga, Ganga Yamuna. This is called as the Rift Valley of Narmada. So this region is the region where your two rivers that flow towards your western coast, two major rivers of India that flow westwards, okay, they flow through this region. Which are those two rivers? Which are two major rivers of India that flow westwards? All other major rivers flow eastwards in India, isn't it? Only two major rivers flow westwards. So one is Narmada and the other is Tapti. So it is the valley of these rivers, all right. Rift Valley, this region is also called as the Rift Valley. So again, this Rift Valley is a location of a fault line, and therefore this region has been included in zone 3. Other than this, the region of Niger, region near the big cities of Mumbai, Pune, and parts of your Western Ghats, these are also included in the zone 3. Some portions of, again, to include Chennai and some portions of Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh, they have brought them into zone 3. Of course, some portions of Gujarat, which are near to Kutch, are in zone 3, and similarly, some portions of Rajasthan. Other than this, the major part of your Deccan Plateau, which is on hard igneous rock, this major part of your Deccan Plateau, this is a tentative location of the Deccan Plateau. So major part of Deccan Plateau you will see in zone 2. Why? Because it is on a very stable igneous rock foundation, the entire Deccan Plateau region. So that is in zone 2 and seismically not vulnerable. All right. Or having a very, very low vulnerability. So if you see area wise, as I had said this thing in the introductory session also, area wise, you will see that large parts of India are in lower seismic zones, zone 2, zone 3. But if you see population wise, large parts of India, population wise, large parts of India lies in zone 3, 4 and 5, isn't it? Because this is the region of our country which is highly populated. This entire Gangetic Plains, these are the one of the highest populated regions. This is one of the highest populated regions. So population wise, if you see, of course, this region also is very heavily populated. Population wise, large parts of our population live in zone 3, 4, 5. Okay. So this is a general seismic map of India. This is, there are of course few problems with it. I would discuss it tomorrow again. So this is scientifically not a very good way of zonation. Okay. This is seismically, the seismic zonation that has been done is not a very good way of doing it. Why? Because if you see, if you look at Ahmedabad, this is in zone 3. And for example, you take another city, let us say Indore. Okay. Indore is right over here, right on the boundary of zone 2 and zone 3. Somewhere over here, there will be Indore. Indore is where I live. I mean, me and my wife, we both live. So this is Indore. So both Indore and Ahmedabad are in zone 3. But during the 2001 earthquake, there was no damage in Indore. Not even a wall, brick wall fell down, isn't it? In the 2001 Bhuj earthquake. And Ahmedabad suffered major damages. There were almost 100 G plus 5, G plus 6 buildings that came down. So there was a huge loss of life and property in Ahmedabad, but there was absolutely no loss of life, no loss of property in Indore. But zone wise, if you see, both are in same zone 3, isn't it? So that way, our zone maps are not very properly done. This type of zonation, this is a very macro level of zonation that has been done. This is not scientifically very good way to do the zonation, isn't it? If you look at the American codes, I would be talking from time to time about the international codes. So if you look at American codes, just like we have IS 1893, which is the American code, for earthquake load calculation. So just like IS 1893, we have over here, the corresponding equivalent American code is, yes, anyone? So the corresponding American code is ASCE 7, okay? American Society of Civil Engineers, and the code number is 7. So this is the code for earthquake load calculation. In the American context, they do not give zones like this. Okay. There is no zone map like this. What they give is, they give the acceleration parameters. So they will give you parameters what are called as spectral long time spectral acceleration and spectral acceleration at 1 second. So they will be giving you, these are also called as SS-S1, short time acceleration, SS, and S1, acceleration at 1 second. spectral acceleration. So if you look at American codes, they give you these values, okay? And then on the basis of your structural type, on the basis of your geological or geotechnical features, then you basically find out the what is called as the seismic design category. All right. So in the American code, the treatment is slightly different and more, I would say, more logical. So you find out the seismic design category. First, you find out the spectral acceleration parameters for your location. Then on the basis of your structure, on the geotechnical data, then you have to, on the importance of your structure, then you have to decide the seismic design category. Okay. So this is how, and this seismic design category, you can say, is loosely equivalent to the zones that we have in India. So this treatment is much more logical and much more appropriate. The treatment that we have in India, Indian context, this zone map, this is not proper. Okay. This is not a good way of doing it. But anyway, this is what we have. So we will have to stick with this for the time being, isn't it? And even our code has gone a step back. I mean, rather than microzonation, which is required, microzonation means you should try to find out the actual acceleration parameters for each and every location. That is called as microzonation. So instead of going to microzonation, we are moving in the backward direction by doing more and more macrozonation, isn't it? Macrozonation means earlier you had zone 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now they have clubbed zone 1 and 2 into zone 2. So they are, instead of going towards micro, they are going towards macrozonation in the opposite direction, isn't it? So that is slightly unfortunate, I would say. Anyway, when we do any big structure, when we are doing any big structure, maybe a big monument, or let us say a big dam project or a big infrastructure project, what is always told us to do the microzonation study. Have you heard about this term, microzonation? All right. So whenever you are doing any important project, this is what is recommended. All right. So you do the actual, you measure the actual ground accelerations. You look at the actual historical data, and then you try to do the microzonation. So this is the process followed for important projects. And this is actually, this should have been adopted by India also in giving the SS-S1 parameters at each and every location. If you see the website, there is a very interesting website. If you could log into USGS, I think, United States Geological Society, I guess. This is their USGS is their organization. And if you look at their website, I don't know the exact address of their website. I think it is usgs.com or usgs.org. So there, they give the SS-S1 parameters for a lot of locations inside US as well as outside the US also. Many locations in Africa, many locations in Asia, many locations in South America, they give the SS-S1 parameters for it. All right. So a very interesting website. You can log into the USGS website and see it. It also measures the earthquake across the world. For example, if you look at this website daily, there are hundreds of earthquakes that are taking place all across the world. But because they are very small in magnitude, they are not felt to the general public. Maybe a 2 Richter scale or a 3 Richter scale earthquake. But there are hundreds of earthquakes striking each and every day. So all those records are available on the USGS website. Very interesting. If you find time, go through it. Anyway, so Indian zone map, just to conclude, Indian zone map is not very good. We should move towards microzonation, but we are moving towards macrozonation. All right. Not a very technically good way of doing it. Maybe in the coming years, in the coming revisions, we will have something, some improvements in this zone map. Till that time, this is what we have. All right. I would be talking more about zones tomorrow. So we'll quickly go ahead. So this is the zone map. So first we saw the seismically vulnerable areas in the world. And then we zoomed into India to see the seismic intensity of India. Okay. Bhutan also, I believe, Nepal, Bhutan, all these will also be in seismic zone 5. Okay. If you follow the Indian practice, then this will also be in zone 5. Bhutan, Nepal, large parts of Pakistan, which are near the North Pakistan, all these regions will also be in zone 5. All right. Good. So I will talk more about seismic zones tomorrow when we come to this point. For the time being, I will move ahead. So these seismic zones that you see, as I told you, India has been divided into 4 zones, seismic zone 2, 3, 4, and 5. So these zones are broadly based on what is called as a MSK intensity scale. Okay. So there's this MSK intensity scale, and our zone map actually depends on this intensity scale. All right. So how it works, I will just go quickly through it. This is from the IS-1893 code that I have taken it. These tables. So, sorry. So, it gives us the type of structure, type A structure, rural, or you could say basic masonry type of a structure, type B, general buildings, type C, reinforced buildings, or well-built wooden structures, etc. And then it gives you some percentage of damages, and then it gives you some grades. Okay. So for example, if I go to any MSK intensity scale, let us say we go to intensity scale 2, scarcely noticeable. Okay. So vibration is felt only by individual people, especially on upper floors. And then they have not given anything about the structure which gets damaged or the nature of damages. So because there was nothing that was felt, these are kept --. I will go to the higher zone. Let us go to MSK intensity 8. So most people are frightened and run outdoors. Many find it difficult to stand. The vibration is noticed by persons, etc. This. What is the type of damages? In many buildings, type C damage. In many buildings of type C. What was type C? Type C were reinforced buildings or well-built wooden structures. So In many buildings of type C, damage of grade 1 is caused. What was damage of grade 1? Grade 1 meant slight damage. Okay. So slight damage, fine cracks in plaster, fall of small pieces of plaster, and slight means about 5%. Single or slight, this means about 5%. Slight means fine cracks of small pieces of plaster, etc. So many buildings of type C undergo grade 1 damage if they are using many. This many means 50% of buildings undergo slight damage. All right. Many buildings of type B, damage is of grade 2. So type B was ordinary brick buildings, ordinary structures. They undergo grade 2 damage, moderate damage. And the word is many. Many means many would mean 50% of buildings undergo this damage. So in this way, this MSK intensity scale has been provided. Okay. Did you get it? How to read it? Yes. Did we understand how it is to be read? How is this MSK intensity scale to be read? So, yes, I hope it was clear. So we had type of structure, type A, type B, type C. Then we had the definition of quantity, where numbers were given, how many of these structures are getting damaged, and then the nature of damage is given. So then in intensity scale, first the how many people are feeling or how many people have felt it, that is given. Then the structures which are damaged, that is given, and the nature of what happens to the nature, that is given. Nature means surrounding, what happens to nature, that is given. So this is how your MSK intensity scale has been given. See, it is highly empirical. This is not very numerically based. All right. There are a lot of empirical and qualitative data over here. The quantitative data is slightly low in this intensity scale, but our Indian code has chosen to follow this. So as per this, I have written over here that the seismic zone map is broadly based on this intensity scale. So if your MSK intensity scale is 6 or less, where do you get your MSK intensity scale? I will just go back. Your MSK intensity scales were given over here. These were the MSK intensity scale. This 3, 4, 5, 6, all these were MSK intensity scales. Okay. So if your MSK intensity scale is 6 or less, then your seismic zone is 2 as per the Indian code. Seismic zone 2. All right. If your MSK intensity scale is 7, then your zone is 3. If your MSK intensity is 8, zone is 4. And for MSK intensity scales 9 and above, zone is 5. So that is how broadly your zone factors have been finalized. All right. Do we get this much? So you will appreciate that this is not a very technical way of doing it, isn't it? There are no acceleration parameters that have been incorporated in this. It is just a loose definitions given in MSK intensity scales that have been followed for zone mapping. So not a very scientifically logical way of doing it, but this is what we have. Are we clear till this point? All right. Then we will quickly go through the two codes that we would be studying. I will quickly go through the evolution of those two codes. So broadly, which are the two codes we would be studying? So we would be focusing on, in this course, we would be focusing on two codes. One is IS-1893 and the other is IS-13920. What is the difference between these two? Yes, anyone would like to comment? Quick comment. What is the difference between these two? Yes, tell me. Difference between these two. So first code, that is the IS-1893. Yes. So first, 1893 is broadly for general, I would say, general considerations and earthquake load calculation. Okay. So 1893 is mainly for general considerations, and it is mainly for EQ load calculation and general considerations. Okay. And then you have got 13920. That is mainly for detailing and design. I have deliberately writing design afterwards. I will tell you why. So 1893 is mainly for detailing and design. All right. So these are two codes broadly that we would be looking at. So remember these two broad, I would say purpose of these two codes is different. One is for load calculation. One is for detailing and designing. So we would be looking, having a look at both. Let us quickly have a look at the 1893 first, and let us quickly look at the evolution of these two codes. I have taken the next two or three slides from a presentation that I gave in the year 2017, I guess. So these two codes were recently launched, and I had given a technical presentation on the new, on the 1893 2016 and on the 13920 2016, highlighting the changes that have occurred. So next two or three slides I have taken from that presentation, which I gave in the year 2017. Okay. Anyway, so the point over here is that there were a lot of earthquakes in the early part of 20th century. There was a big earthquake in Kutch. There was a big earthquake in Nepal. There was a very big earthquake in Afghanistan. So that led to a formal work on creating a seismic zone map for India. So this was the time we were still being ruled by Britishers. So we developed a sort of a rough zone map in the early, I would say, 30s or 40s, 1930s, 1940s. But the first time an institutional setup was created in University of Roorkee, that now is IIT Roorkee. This is where I and Akanksha did our masters. So first time, I think in 1950s, somewhere in 1950s, for the first time, a department was set up. And it was set up at University of Roorkee. And formal work was started on the earthquake engineering in India. So that work was basically started by Dr. Jay Krishna. He did his master's and PhD from some American university, and then he came back to India. So those days, Nehruji, Pandit Nehru, had given a call to all the Indians studying abroad to come back and serve the country. So many professors, many distinguished PhD holders, people who are working outside came back to our country because Nehruji had called them. So this Professor Jay Krishna was also one of them who came back. He came back and he joined UOR, University of Roorkee, and set up this department. And then in 1962, we got our first 1893. Okay. So IS-1893 for the first time came out in the year 1962. And then subsequently, there were revisions. So after 1962, there was a revision in 67, 70, 75, 84, and 2002. And now we have got it in 2016. One thing you will notice over here. Can you notice one thing in the years of revision? Yes. Can anyone notice one thing that is pretty evident in the years that you see, revision years? So you will see that in the early 60s and 70s, the revision used to happen at a very good pace, isn't it? You see, 62 first code, 67 revision, 5 years. Then after 3 years, again a revision. After 5 years, again a revision. So this was a good pace of codal revisions, isn't it? After this, from 75 to 84, 9 years, no revision. After 9 years, there was a revision. Over here, 16 years, no revision. After 16 years, there was a revision. Again, from 2002 to 2016, again, 14 years, there was no revision. So this is a sad state with all the Indian standards that you see these days, isn't it? All the Indian standards that you see were revised at a good rate in 60s and 70s. But now when you look at them in 80s, 90s, 2000s, absolutely there is nothing happening, isn't it? If you even if you look at IS 456, which is the revision that we are studying, IS 456. Yes, tell me, 2000, isn't it? So 21 years have passed. 21 years have passed since the last revision of 456. And again in 2021, they have reaffirmed it. So now there is a code out, the same 456 2000, they have reaffirmed it again 21 years afterwards. Similarly, if you look at IS 800, that is the steel design code, we are right now following 2007. That is again 14 years old. And that too was revised after a gap of 23 years, isn't it? It was revised in 1984. And then it was revised 23 years after 2007. And again, 14 years have passed. We have no revision. So this is a pretty sad state of Indian standards in our country these days. In 60s, 70s, the codes were getting revised at a very quick pace. But then suddenly, gradually, I don't know why this progress was halted. Mr. Akash is asking, what is the meaning of reaffirm? Reaffirm means the codal committee sits down and they say that everything looks fine. Let us continue with the same code. Okay, so that is meaning of reaffirmed. Ki sab theek hai, as we would call it in Hindi, sab theek hai, isi ko chalne do. Isn't it? That is the meaning of reaffirmed. So, it was expected actually that this year a new 456 will come out. But again, 2021, they have reaffirmed the old 2000. Anyway, so right now we have the 2016 revision. This is the sixth revision of 1893. In the year 2002, this code was split into five parts. All right. So till 84, we had only IS 1893. After 2002, it was split in five parts. So now we have IS 1893 part 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. That part 5 is, I think, still under progress, under development, I think. Isn't it? So the latest revision we have got is in year 2016, which we would be referring to. So if I quickly go to the code, how the title page looks like, this is how the title page looks like for the current revision, 1893, 2016. So what is the title? Criteria for earthquake resistant design of structures, general provisions and buildings. These are covered in part one. On the left side, I have just pasted a screenshot of the other parts. So part one is for general provisions. Part two is for liquid retaining tanks. If you remember in one of our earlier courses, I think it was STC 10. In one of our earlier courses, we had done extensive design using the part two. I think some of you were part of that course. So we had done extensive calculations using the IS 1893 part 2, isn't it? That part 2 is for liquid retaining structures. Then part 3 is for bridges, retaining walls. Part 4 is for industrial structures. Part 5 is for dams and embankments. I'm not sure, is it out or not? Can anyone tell me? Is the part 5 out or... it is not out yet. Yes, I am not very sure with the current status of part 5. So someone can just help me with that. Anyway, so 1893 in five parts we have right now. All right. then if you look at 13920, so in the year 1967, when the second revision of 1893 came out, in the year 1967, along with the 1893 revision that came out, there was this code that was issued, which was called as IS 4326. So that was a general guideline for earthquake resistant design and construction of building. This was a general guideline, okay, sort of a handbook that you get. Then subsequently it was revised in year 1976, which this code 4326 was subsequently revised in the year 1976. Then in the year 1993, this 4326, which was actually a general guide for construction of buildings, it was divided into several parts. So you had a IS 13827, which was for improving the resistance of earthen buildings, earthquake resistance of earthen buildings. Then you had IS 13828, which was for improving earthquake resistance of low strength masonry buildings. Then you had 13935, which was repair and strengthening of structures for earthquake, for seismic effects. And then you had the 13920, which was ductile detailing of RCC structures. So basically, if you see, in the year 1993, India was perhaps one of the only country to have codes covering different types of structures, right from earthen buildings. We had a code for low strength masonry buildings. We had a separate code for repair and strengthening, and we had a separate code for RC structures. So it was one of the early countries which covered the entire spectrum. Okay, right from low strength non-engineered masonry to RCC construction. This was in year 1993. Then suddenly everything stopped and you didn't have a new code for the next, how many years? 23 years. For the next 23 years, there was no code. There was absolute silence over here, absolute gap period, 23 years. So after 23 years, then in 2016, you got this new 13920. So this was a major revision that was undertaken. I would say perhaps this should have been a new code in itself. It was so thoroughly revised. This old 13920 was so thoroughly revised that it was no longer a revision. It was in itself a new code that they brought out. All right. But anyway, they decided to keep the same name, 13920. And the most important change that they did, that till now it was only a detailing code, isn't it? Till now, if you look at the 13920 title, 1993 title, it is only ductile. The language says that it is ductile detailing of RC structures subjected to seismic forces. This is the name. But in 2016, it underwent a massive change, and now it includes design also. So now it no longer remains a detailing code. Now it includes clauses for design. So therefore, it becomes very important for us. Us means the structural designers who we are. It becomes very important for us to understand this code, because now it has implications on design as well. Till now, they were mainly detailing criteria. Even if you took some, you left some, you were good. It was okay with respect to a structure. But now, because it has design criteria also, it becomes very important for us to understand. Okay. So this is the 13920-2016 code that we have, which we would be studying in great detail during the course. So if you see, in the year 2016, there were two major CODEL revisions, both to 1893 and 13920 happened in 2016. And then you also had a tall building design code, isn't it? What is the tall building design code number? So that is IS 16700. So if I remember correctly, that was also brought out in the year 17. So in these 3 years, you had three major codes getting upgraded or launched. So it was a major, I would say, year in the Indian standards for us, the structural engineers. Yeah, in the year 2015, one more major code was revised. In the year 2015, which code was revised? One major code that we use. Yes, anyone remembers? So it was IS 875 part 3, isn't it? Yes, 875 part 3 for wind. So if you see last 5-6 years, 3-4 major codes which have a lot of importance for structural engineers have been revised. All right. But two major codes still remain unrevised. That is 456. Last was 2000, and even 800 is now 14 years old. So these two still needs quick revision. If you look at the American codes, it is a practice that at every 2 years, I think it is compulsory for them to revise their standards. So if you look at the corresponding concrete code that you have, it is called as ACI 318. So ACI 318 gets revised every 2 years, I think 2 or 3 years. Similarly, if you look at IS 800, the corresponding American code is, what is the corresponding American code? AISC 360. Yes, Prasad sir is an expert in steel design. So AISC 360, yes. And I don't remember which is the current year, but this AISC also gets revised pretty quickly. Okay. So Indian standards have to follow good pace. Unfortunately, they are still lagging behind in the speed of their revisions. Anyway, so we were fortunate enough when we were studying at Roorkee, I and Akanksha, we were fortunate enough that one of our professors who taught us this course on earthquake engineering, he is Professor Y. Singh. So he was on the CODEL committee of IS 1893. You can see his name in the CODEL committee. And my M.Tech guide, Professor A.K. Jain, sir, he is on the CODEL committee of IS 13920, isn't it? So we have had the good fortune to be in company of these great civil engineers. Anyway, keeping this apart, so these are the two codes which we would be focusing on. So this was just an initial introduction that I wanted to give you about the evolution of codes and what lies in store for us. All right. So tomorrow when we meet, we are finishing slightly early because it is the first day. We are going a bit slow. So tomorrow when we meet, we would start in detail our study of 1893. So how will we proceed? First, we will discuss 1893 because we need to do the load calculation. So wherever required, we will do manual calculations. Wherever required, we will go to software, and that is how we will progress. All right. Once we understand the load calculations, then we will go to the design part that we will do by using 13920. So that is how we are going to proceed. Tomorrow we shall start with 1893. So first we'll discuss the important seismic parameters from tomorrow. Okay, that is how we shall proceed. So if you have any questions, all of you have been added to our integrated portal where you would be able to watch these sessions online. We will share the procedure for watching those sessions. Those of you who have already been taking courses with Auxin, they know the procedure. For those who are taking it for the first time, a detailed procedure will be shared with all of you on the group, how to watch these sessions. So every session would be uploaded online, let us say by 11:30 PM. So you can watch them, and all the sessions would be available for 6 months from today. All right. And every session after completion will be uploaded within 2 hours. Generally within 2 hours, it gets uploaded. So we will stop. This is all what I had for today. If you have any questions, you may ask now. Anything that you want to ask? Yes. anything? Very good. So no questions today. Thank you then. We will now see you tomorrow, and we will start with 1893. All right. Thank you. Have a good day. Have a good day tomorrow. We will see you at 7:30. All right. Bye-bye. Good night.